Institute of Mathematical Sciences is a pure basic sciences research institute, and we basically are involved in research in four major areas of science, all the mathematical sciences. So one is of course mathematics, the other is physics, then theoretical computer science. You heard now about how you write theorems on programs. Kamal just talked to you about it. So it's not computer science, but theoretical computer science. And recently, a year ago, we've started an area of computational biology. So it's the mathematics of biology. It is not biology. So it's basically various kinds of mathematics. So if you ask us questions which are not related to these sciences, we will try our best. If we don't know the answer, we will try and find out. Okay? There is nothing wrong in asking a question, and there is nothing wrong in not knowing the answer. Fine? So with that, let me begin. So these are the four major areas, just for you to keep in mind. And maybe I should also say one more word. Those of you who are in 12th standard, we actually take students for research after the BSc program. So you can finish your BSc and then come here and get a master's degree on the way if you're interested in research in any one of these four areas, okay? And you can look at our website for more details. So this is kind of advance notice. So starting from the left, Professor Shankar, a physicist who works on various sciences apart from condensed matter physics, the science of tsunami, science of glaciers, and climate change. So next is Professor Balasubramanian, whom you might have met in the morning, director of our institute, very well-known number theorist. So basically mathematician, if you don't know what number theory is. We have a sister institute in the city called Chennai Mathematical Institute, which actually takes students after 12th standard. So there's a lot of exchange of ideas and people between these two institutes. And Dr. Hanumanto is from CMI. He's a mathematician, and I'm afraid I don't know what is his area of research.
Algebraic geometry.
Okay, so he works in algebraic geometry. Then Professor Ghanshyam Date is also a physicist, and you would have heard him give a talk, right? So he works in gravity, quantum loop gravity, and theoretical ideas related to unifying gravity with quantum mechanics. But as I said, you can ask any question that you wish. So this is our panel. There are other institute members in this audience, and they're also welcome to answer a question that our faculty here cannot answer. It's a very informal session. So I think I will just start by asking any one of you to ask a question. Myself, okay, I'm not going to answer any questions. I'm Indumati. I'm moderating this affair. I work in particle physics. I'm a physicist too. Yeah, okay. Yeah, if you keep track of science in the news, then there is this project proposal called India-based neutrino observatory, where we want to build a neutrino lab in India, and I have been part of that project now for many years, decades actually. Come, are you coming downstairs or are you staying up there? If you're coming downstairs, please come quietly. If you're staying there, please stay quietly. Thanks. Yeah. Okay. So first question. Yeah. Yeah, first question. Yeah, it's very, very disturbing. Yeah, settle down there. Blue and white, please settle down. Yeah. First question? Two missing, doesn't matter. Yeah. Who wants to ask a question or you just want to hear answers? Yeah. Here, eduthukonga. Pass pandringla? I'll find one.
My question is upon gravity. Actually, I didn't attend that lecture, but I'm very much curious about gravity because there is a lot many curious question about gravity in my mind. But actually, all my learning in physics, which I have learned that gravity much more depend upon mass. Like higher the mass, higher the gravitational field. But there is certain questions like Sun is having more mass than Earth. So, but there are some certain more reactions going with inside the Sun, like nuclear fusion and all, etc. Those things are going on. So, are those things also like increasing its gravitational effect, or is it only the mass of this thing? Because like in the black hole, as if no, it consists of immense gravitational field. It can pull light also inside it. So all those things I want to know. Like, what are all the factors affecting gravity or increasing its effect or decreasing its effect? because it is known as the least the gravitational force is the least force, felt force among the all four forces, like strong forces, nuclear forces. So why is it so?
Transfer it. Okay, the question is somewhat slightly nebulous. I'm not exactly sure, but I will try to answer some of it. When we say there are four interactions, so obviously they will simply say that if there is one object which has the appropriate attributes like charge or color or weak charge, then it will interact with an object of similar type of thing, and that interaction, therefore different interactions are distinguished by their properties, namely what are the two objects or three objects they influence, what is their strength, which reactions take place and which don't, what is their range. Suppose for example strong force will not be operational when you are sitting there, I am sitting here, so that distance is too large. Likewise, gravity is a force which is going to be acting on everything which carries inertia, that is mass, or equivalently energy by special theory of relativity. So anything which has mass and energy will participate in gravitational interaction, either exerting the force or responding to it. When you distinguish between exertion and response by simply saying which one is bigger and which one is smaller. For example, if the sun is very big and I am standing, I am also exerting a force on sun, but that force is too small to move the sun. Whereas sun's force on me is much too stronger because I am smaller, so I can move, I will respond to that more easily. So I will be considered a test particle for the sun's motion, whereas sun will not be considered a test particle for my motion. Okay? So that is one distinction. So source for gravitational force or gravitational interaction is the mass or energy. That was the first question you had. Second question you had, some comment was whether the fusion reaction, nuclear reactions, etc. taking place in sun, whether they have any influence. Whether they have any influence on the gravitational interaction? Indirectly, yes, because if they contribute to energy, then yes. But directly, just because it is the case, the answer is no. So gravitational interactions are sensitive only to the net mass or energy and not what it is made up of. So I hope that answers your question. What about black hole? Sorry, I missed the question.
Question was, I'm not very much clear about black holes, because what is the thing which is causing like immense gravitational field, like singularity, which is causing singularity?
Okay, first of all, the black holes that we are aware of from the theory point of view, they can only have certain attributes, namely they have mass, they can be rotating, so they have angular momentum, and they can have electric charge. These are the three attributes that one can have, that is what the theory will say. Okay, so anything else, whatever the black hole may be formed by dumping garbage or sending in whatever you want to send in, all that will remain finally. It's the only memory that will be retained is the total mass, total angular momentum and charge. Most of the time astrophysically will say that there won't be any charge, because if the charge existed, it will attract oppositely charged electrons and other particles which are around, and it will go and neutralize it. So one expects that astrophysically you will only see the mass and angular momentum. Now, the strength of this depends upon, when you say that Earth's gravity on the surface is 980 centimeter per second square, that is because we are at the surface of Earth whose radius is about 6600 kilometers. If you retain the same mass of Earth but shrunk Earth to a very small size, something like few centimeters, then Earth's gravity will also be extremely small, because it is same gm divided by r square, where r is very very small. So black hole has a strong gravity because it's extremely compact. Its size is very small. In fact, technically it's supposed to be same as the so-called Schwarzschild radius, which for Sun will be 3 kilometers, and if the mass is 10 times the mass of Sun, this will be 10 times the 3 kilometers. So the radius of the black hole or size of the black hole is proportional to the mass, and for normalization, solar mass, black hole will have size of about 3 kilometers. So gravity is strong simply because the Sun is shrunk to that smaller size of 3 kilometers instead of 600,000 kilometer radius. And that's the reason that black hole gravity is stronger than gravity. But however, if the Sun tomorrow were to become a black hole, it will have no effect on Earth as far as this orbit is concerned. So gravity doesn't get stronger because it has become a black hole. It is stronger because you can get close to black hole, and there the gravity is very strong.
Yeah, just just one moment. No, I think I will pass it on to, because we don't have much time.
Sure, sure.
Even I would like to invite a question in maths.
Questions.
Okay, fine. Anybody else? Yeah, please ask.
Okay.
Yeah, sure, fine. Ask your questions. So the suggestion is we'll take two or three questions and then decide what to ask.
My only one and only question. As photon, particles of light is considered as massless particles.
So say it again.
Photons.
Yeah.
Particles of light are massless, considered.
Yeah.
So, as gravity depends upon the mass, how does a black hole trap in the sun, I mean the light whichever comes to it?
When one says a photon is massless,
let's ask for a couple of questions.
Oh, sorry. And then ask.
Some more questions? Yeah.
Okay, I have two. Okay. Let's see. So, one is the Higgs boson. Okay, what exactly is the Higgs boson? I mean, I know it provides mass to a certain object and all that, but what exactly is it? And two,
Stephen Hawking, he recently said, oh, black holes, they're not true, like the event horizon and everything. They're not exactly, it's not exactly them. So explain that, and actually I have three questions. And what exactly is a singularity like? What exactly is it?
My question is related to atom. Atom has a positively charged sphere and the negatively charged electrons in it. Why don't they get neutralized?
One more? Last question for the session. One set, huh?
There's one there.
Yeah.
Yes.
Ask.
Yes. Yes. Ask more.
If we can't know you, we'll pass up.
Okay. So quantum, and I have a question about quantum entanglement. So quantum entanglement says that a particle can be at two places at the same time, but when we try to make a measurement, we will get only one result. So it can never be scientifically tested. So how can we say it's a scientific theory when it cannot be tested? How can we say that it can be in two places at the same time when it cannot be tested?
No, but I am looking for some question in math. Nobody has
a
question in
math. Okay. Imaginary numbers used in real life.
How
are imaginary numbers useful in real life?
That's boring physics again.
How are imaginary numbers useful in real life?
Used in real life. There is a book, no, which has just been given in the packet. I haven't read it, but I just saw it.
Okay, I am going to be completely biased and prejudiced and ask for this question to be answered first. Just for a change.
Sorry.
How are imaginary numbers useful in real life?
Yes, one more question.
No, we take more questions after these are right. Just want to start off with, because it's difficult to ask questions in math, I understand that. So I was looking for at least one, now I want at least one. You?
No, imaginary.
You are using it only for calculations.
No, only the physicists use it.
People anyway don't do anything in the related to real life. Never. This question doesn't even arise. You know. See the.
Yeah.
Well, yes. At least I can say what we very commonly use it for in physics. So, basically there is, in physics we keep coming across oscillations, waves and oscillations, the world is full of cycling objects. I mean, there's night, then there's day, it's a periodic phenomena. Then our AC current, voltage goes up, down, then waves in the ocean, their amplitude goes up, down. So we always need periodic functions in physics, lot of them we have to deal with. So the basic periodic function are these sine functions and cos functions. Sine omega t, cos omega t, you may have come across. If you have ever plotted the sine function, you'll see that it is periodic. It goes up, goes down. Now imaginary numbers e to the power I omega t is sin omega t plus I, it's cos omega t plus I sin omega t. Pardon? Oh, okay, it's written on the board. So we find it very convenient to use the complex number instead of sine and cos. And so all types of periodic phenomena, we keep using this imaginary numbers. And it's extremely useful for us that way.
There are a lot of phenomena in physics particularly, or in engineering. Yeah. These phenomena is something which you want to study. Okay, this is what, and the mathematics turns out to be the correct language to study the phenomena. And therefore, whether these phenomena themselves or using any imaginary number, for example, in order for a particle, whether it decides to go to a place X or a Y, whether it does a calculation using imaginary numbers and it decides, etc., we don't know. But on the other hand, if we want to study on a paper and a pencil, how, what the motion of a particle would be, that essentially is a certain differential equations. Therefore, everything is reduced to the mathematics. And the mathematics using complex analysis turns out to be easier and more powerful to study the many phenomena compared to not using the complex analysis. Okay? That exactly is what makes the importance of complex analysis. And to give a completely different example from number theory, for example, when Riemann wanted to know how many prime numbers are there, this is of course, then you would think that you have to know about the integers 1, 2, 3, 4 and you have to know nothing about it because you are only trying to count the prime numbers. And then he had a mathematical model for it. And then using the mathematical model, he studied it. And the mathematical model does involve studying a so-called analytic function of a complex variable. And even today, there is no natural proof of the prime number theorem without using complex analysis. Therefore, this is what exactly happens. There are a lot of phenomena. This phenomena is what we want to do or study. We want to do the mathematical modeling, and then we want to see what is the mathematics that is necessary to use. And then the complex analysis plays a very important role. Okay? Therefore, this mathematics is something which we are using to study the phenomena, whether this phenomena really want follow any mathematical rule or something like that, or we are only using mathematics to study them, that is not very clear. But that, since that is the only tool which is available for us to study, which is all what we are doing. And therefore, the mathematics, the complex analysis becomes important.
Okay, so I'll briefly say.
Yeah, you want to add something? Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so I will just build on what Professor Balu said. So just first, let me say that a lot of mathematics that we do is not, we never ask whether it's useful or not. I mean, starting with imaginary numbers. As he said, some of the mathematics is actually used in studying various physical phenomena, but that's not really the reason that why we study these things. So that's number one. And coming back to the imaginary number, it, in my own area of algebraic geometry where we study solutions to polynomial equations, it becomes much more interesting if we allow imaginary numbers. Okay? So for example, if you take, if you're working only with integers or rational numbers, or if some of you know what real numbers are, decimal numbers and so on, you all know that there is no square root for minus 1, right? That's the first imaginary number that you know. So you can obviously stop there and say that minus 1 has no square root, but mathematicians would not do that. They will try to continue the study and maybe develop theories without always worrying about whether it's useful or not. So algebraic geometry over complex numbers is much more interesting because you have a solution for, in fact, for any polynomial equation you can, right, there is always a solution, which is not the case for rational numbers or real numbers or integers. So the use of imaginary numbers is to make the theory much more rich and interesting. Okay? So that's what happens in my day-to-day work.
Maybe I can add just one comment. The comment is related to the physics aspect of it. It is true, many of these things are convenient using complex numbers, I mean from application point of view, but some of them in principle can also be done using real numbers. However, there is one area where you have to use complex numbers, and that's quantum mechanics. Without quantum mechanics, you cannot do without complex numbers, you cannot do quantum mechanics. This is just food for thought, figure it out, it is true.
Well, the atoms and the quantum are the one, because the two are related in a very interesting way. Actually, the same question that why doesn't the electron fall into the nucleus, you can ask why doesn't the moon fall into the earth? Because the moon is also attracting the earth, the earth is also attracting the moon. Moon can also fall into the earth. But that was answered during the gravity thing. It doesn't fall in because it is moving. So by the time it falls, it has moved enough far away that it doesn't get closer to the earth. Or in other simple words, we can say that there's a centrifugal force. Because it is going around in a circle, there's a centrifugal force which is pushing the particle outside, away. And there's an attractive gravitational force, and the two are balancing each other. Same way in atom, it can happen that if the electron is going round and round, there's a centrifugal force which is trying to make it go away, and that is balancing the electrical force which is trying to pull it towards the center. So this is okay, but then at the end of the last century, people asked another question. Okay, suppose the electron is going round and round the atom. It will slowly lose energy somewhere due to friction. I mean, it is after all interacting with laws of other particles, it is never isolated. So it can lose energy. Then if its energy becomes less, it will go slower, then it will come closer to the nucleus. So every electron should actually keep making smaller and smaller circles and finally collapse. So those days people called it ultraviolet catastrophe. What did they call it?
It's related to stability of atom.
People.
I think Bohr's atom model.
So this was.
He actually added this one fact, right? That Rutherford just said that you have positive charges with negative charges going around, but then you know that will spiral into the nucleus. So Bohr said that it can only go in certain orbitals.
This was the question that motivated quantum mechanics actually. Why does the electron not fall into the proton? Why does the electron not fall into... People called it some catastrophe. In their minds it was a big problem. Why are atoms stable? And then quantum theory came because of that. And how does quantum theory explain it? Quantum theory says that the particle that is going around cannot have all energies. It can have only energy 1 by 2, 1 by 3, 1 by 4, some set, discrete set of energies. So it cannot slowly lose energy and fall into the atom. Yeah, there's another question here, I think.
No, let's answer the full set of questions here. So now this question specifically, I would like to give him an answer. Plus and minus charges now. Who asked this question? Yeah, you understood? They don't fall into each other because they are circling around each other, and you will find when you grow up that if you're staying in physics, angular momentum is one of the most important concepts, and you probably have not heard about it yet. So you'll have to wait a little while. When you hear about angular momentum, it is because of angular momentum something is circling around something else, okay, and that's why it doesn't collapse. Okay, thank you, Shankar. Maybe now we should go to which one do you want to go to? We have done this quantum entanglement not being tested. Actually, you just have two more sentences to add to this. So
actually, you are not asking about quantum entanglement. You are really talking about quantum interference. Let me interpret the question. You are saying that quantum mechanics postulates that a particle can be in two places at the same time. So how is this testable? So actually, what it postulates really is that the probability of the particle being that you cannot say where the particle is, you can only give the probability of a particle being at some point. So there's this famous double slit experiment described in many textbooks. So suppose a particle has two ways to come. So suppose there's a particle coming from one side of a screen, there are two holes. then in some sense the particle passes through both the holes. It can either be here or here. So without going into details, this experiment actually has been directly tested using electron microscopes, the electrons that come from electron microscopes, and you can make holes using magnets, and you can plot the probability of the particle having come from this point, I mean, or a combination of the two, and very, very directly tested. You see, because probabilities are what the quantum mechanics predicts, so in order to test probabilities, you have to do the experiment many times. So that is how quantum mechanics is tested, that you repeat the experiment many times and find what are the probabilities of various occurrences the same as what is predicted by the theory. I don't know if I've answered it, but...
Okay, maybe I'll just give you an example. Suppose I say that the probability of something happening is 1 by 10, right? Suppose the probability of getting hot water from a tap is 1 by 10 and 90% of the time it gives you cold water. Now, as you point out, if I open the tap, I will either get cold water or hot water. So, but if I do the experiment 100 times, then 90 of those times I will get cold water, 10 of those times I will get hot water, and that is what actually is the test of quantum mechanics. So it's not a single occurrence that you will test. Repeatedly you will do the experiment again and again, and there are quantum mechanical equivalences which tell you how this probability of doing it many times is related to actually the one-time probability of that event happening. So there is a certain technical underlying thing which we are not going to obviously derive on the board right now. Okay, fine. Quiet please at the top, I can't hear, thank you. That's exactly what he said, you can't test this. You can't test it. It's been tested many times in many situations. You want to say something?
So when a particle is in a superposition of two states, the probabilities of it being at some point is affected by that. It is like interference of two waves. So suppose you had two holes and the particle is coming out of it. When it is in a superposition, you will expect an interference pattern. If it is not in a superposition, you'll just get two lumps. And experimentally, you can actually verify that it's an interference pattern. In real experiments nowadays, in fact, if you go to the web, they'll show you movie pictures of electrons coming in one by one and forming a very nice interference pattern.
Have you learned any quantum mechanics? No, okay. Then I can't give you the example I was thinking of. We'll leave it at that point, okay? Only thing is that there's a probability which is related to the probability amplitude by its square, okay? So if you have one event occurring some fraction of the time, if what he talked about, the two-slit experiment, you'll have twice the probability amplitude and therefore four times the intensity. Now you will never get four times the intensity because two squared becomes four, right? But classically, you'll only get two. So you can actually test between quantum mechanics and classical mechanics by looking for intensity as opposed to amplitude, okay? Now this is, as I said, just keep those like words in mind, intensity versus amplitude, and you can go and look this up when you either learn it in school or maybe somewhere else, okay? Fine, so I think photons are massless, how gravity affects it, and Higgs boson, black hole singularity, Shyam?
So let me come to photons. When one says photons are massless, you should compare that with the statement that some other particle like proton or something has a mass. What it really means is that there is a frame in which you can go with respect to which the object has speed zero. Photons being massless is a statement, there is no frame in which speed of light is zero, and which is a statement of special theory of relativity. So the statement that it has zero mass is what technically one should call rest mass, and there is no rest mass for photon. So that's what masslessness of photon means. Nevertheless, photon does have energy, and energy can gravitate. And since energy can gravitate, it can respond to gravitational field. And that's the reason the light can still respond to gravitational field, because it carries energy. The question was, I don't know, it was somewhere here.
Yeah.
So does that answer your question? And there was other question, can I just take that? Black hole singularity something?
What was?
Yeah, there were some three questions there. Here.
So Stephen Hawking, he said black holes, they don't exist.
Yes.
Or maybe are we looking at black holes wrong?
Right. Why is he saying that? Okay, instead of saying why is he saying that, let me say what the statement means. So when we say black hole, the common conception of black hole is to say that what technically when you call a classical black hole is a statement that it is an object from which nothing can come out. So it has a certain size, and one will say that it's a very compact object and nothing can come out of it. That is the conception of what a black hole is. One will say mathematically or more technically it has something called the event horizon. Okay? So that is what one will say, that was the notion of what black hole is. Now if that notion is taken, then one leads to something called information loss puzzle, which I just flashed on the transparency, I didn't explain it. So if you incorporate quantum mechanics, then such an object will then say it will create particles, and some particles will escape to infinity, I mean go far away, and some will fall inside, and in the end this object which is a black hole, which eventually evaporate, which will disappear. If it disappears, then there is a conflict with loss of information, and in order to avoid that, one tries to say how can you modify the model of what you mean by black hole by something else. Now it is that model of black hole which is modified, and when Hawking says that black holes don't exist, he means that classical conception of black hole that you had, those black holes with that definition don't exist, is what his current belief is. Okay, the object is still very compact, but it technically doesn't have this event horizon or null hypersurface. So that is all that he means by the black holes don't exist. He's not saying that suddenly the object becomes very large or so. So that means now one has to find out a different microscopic theory to say what happens to a collapsing object if it becomes very dense. So that is an open problem to be figured out. So that answers Hawking thing. What were two other questions, right? What were the? No, that is, she will answer it.
That's all. The other,
no, somebody else said some singularity something was there. Was it same question? Right. Okay, here singularity is a statement. Okay, there are various notions of singularity and various types of singularities and so on. Let's look at the simplest one. So we take a spherically symmetric collapsing object, and let's say it has collapsed so much, the gravity is so strong that there is nothing to halt it. Nothing hits up to support it. It has got that stage, that such stages are possible in Einstein's theory. When that happens, it goes on shrinking, and whatever mass it started with, finite mass, not infinite mass, it can still go to arbitrarily small size. Size zero is a limiting statement, and that is what one will say, that is where something becomes infinite, and that is one version of what is meant by singularity. So the physical quantity such as density will get infinitely high. Even if they don't become infinitely high, but they become 10 power 55 grams per cc, that is as good as infinity as far as real consequences are concerned. It doesn't have to be really infinity. Okay? So that is one notion. There are many other notions. Just to make an sophisticated statement, abstract definition of singularity is space-time is geodesically incomplete. This is just, I'm throwing some words, I'm not explaining it. But there are versions, this is just to indicate that apart from simple notion of singularity as something becoming very dense and very concentrated, there are other notions which you have to define, and those are available. But those are not the ones that one will come across. Similarly, early universe singularity, Big Bang singularity, is also supposed to be that entire universe started with an extremely tiny size. So that is the notion of singularity that one has. That is why I said there are different types of singularity. There is not one singularity which is there. Okay. So the different types, these are only two, still simplest one. The still most symmetrical situation. There are many, many much more complicated singularities, where if you take a room, the room will start shrinking in two directions, expanding in third direction. This will keep on oscillating. And as you approach the early universe, if a model of this kind, you don't know exactly what is going to happen, which size is contracting, which size is expanding, and so on. That's also a form of singularity called BKL singularity. So there are a whole lot of types of singularities. So I can't give a simple answer to that, because that will be false if I give a simple answer. But I can tell there are two examples of singularity, which is simplest, and that's a Big Bang and a spherically symmetric star collapsing into a almost zero size.
Higgs boson? You want me to? Okay. So I want some attention from the top row over there. You have a question to ask? Let me just answer one last question on the Higgs boson, and then you can ask your question. Okay? But please, this is not a classroom. So if you're not interested, you can actually leave. Right? You do a disservice to those who want to listen. So please listen. Yeah? Thank you. Here, this little group over there, if you're not interested, you can actually go away, right? And in fact, probably lunch is available on the other side, so you can actually enjoy your lunch. But if you are in this classroom, I please request you to pay attention, okay?
come in and sit down quickly. Yeah, just occupy all those rows. Yeah, keep moving. Yeah, okay. So this Higgs boson is a very technical thing.
It's not easy.
So except it's made the press so much that maybe, you know, it's important to give an explanation for what the Higgs is. I try to put it in one sentence over here. What we deal with when we talk about particles is something called quantum field theory. Now, I'm not going to explain what quantum field theory is, but it involves quantum mechanics, and I think many of you have heard about quantum mechanics, right? We know that when we talk about atomic sizes, then the kind of mechanics that Newton talked about, all of Newton's laws, don't hold good. We have to modify those laws according to something called quantum mechanics. Apart from quantum mechanics, because those electrons, by the way, the electron in the atom is going around at almost 1/100th of the velocity of light, which is very, 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 very fast, okay? Because of that, you have to be consistent with the special theory of relativity. So, once you make them consistent with both quantum mechanics and special theory of relativity, you have to add one more element in order to get a quantum field theory. And that is a principle called a symmetry principle. So, I have a chalk which is this way. Now, you can see that I'm rotating the chalk. But at this point, you don't know whether I've rotated it by 180 degrees or 360 degrees because it's actually symmetric about this vertical line, right? So it's going to be the same whether I rotate it by 180 or 360. So this is an example of a symmetry principle, okay? So when I add these symmetries, I get a quantum field theory, and these quantum field theories are very useful to understand interactions between fundamental particles like electrons and stuff like that. Now it turns out that the way in which we build these theories, because of our limitation, we don't know what it is really, we are not able to actually include masses in this theory very easily. We can put in, you know, the fact that the electron has a charge. We can put in the fact that electron has spin half because it obeys Pauli principle. You know, when you fill up orbitals, you cannot put more than two electrons in the same orbital, right? So you can put in all those concepts, but it's very hard to put in any non-zero masses for these particles. The moment you put in a mass for the particle, the symmetry simply breaks. And then you're completely lost. Please listen over there. You're very noisy. We can hear you because of the echo, okay? Okay? So what happens is that if you want to maintain the symmetry, you cannot give a mass to the particle. So the way in which mass is given to all fundamental particles, because we know in nature, you can go and do an experiment and measure the electron mass, right? We know all these particles have mass. So the way the masses are given is through a trick, and that is what Higgs and company, actually half a dozen people, showed, is that you think of mass as an interaction. So just like you have repulsion between two electrons or attraction between electron and proton through electromagnetic interactions, you have interaction between the particle and some field. See, this is the field, okay? I'm not going to describe what that field is now, but the interaction between some field, which is called the Higgs field, and the particle, and that interaction gives mass to every particle. This is the meaning of the mass. So when you say in school, you learn mass is the measure of the inertia of a body, right? What it means, I mean, what is inertia? I don't know. Inertia is measured by the mass of the body. So it's kind of a tautology. Mass becomes an extremely complicated concept, and at this point it is simply introduced as an interaction. So how do you know that this interaction actually exists? Because the Higgs field interacts with itself to give itself mass, and that interaction, self-interaction, is seen as a particle called the Higgs boson. So what people have discovered is this Higgs boson. Once you know that this Higgs boson exists, you know that therefore the Higgs field should have existed, because after all, this Higgs boson is the self-interaction of the Higgs field, and therefore you believe that the whole mass mechanism of all these particles is really true. So you can see it's a very technical explanation, not easy to follow. But finally, you find that simple thing like mass can only be explained as an interaction with such a field. Is it okay? Yeah. Oh, one second. There was a question upstairs there, and then I'll take your questions. Huh? It's related to this? Okay, ask. Yeah, you cannot, I mean, I do not have an explanation beyond this. If this is the answer that actually already Shyam has given you. If you have a photon which has no mass, then there's no way you can bring it to rest, because it must have non-zero energy, okay? Otherwise it's nothing. If it has no energy and no mass, it doesn't exist, right? Because then there's no way of actually seeing it or feeling it or, you know, observing it through any of its interactions. So a photon doesn't have mass, but it always has energy. Right? Yeah, because it has mass. Higgs boson is extremely heavy. Higgs boson is about 130 times heavier than a proton. It's extremely, extremely heavy.
One rough intuitive way of thinking of giving this mass, I mean, if it's an object which is, say, even light, and it passing through medium, it doesn't have the speed of light. The speed of light in vacuum is different from speed of light in medium. That happens because life keeps interacting with whatever is in the medium, and therefore, effectively, if I measure the time taken by light to go from point A to point B, and divide that distance by time, I'll get the speed to be less. So in other words, it's the propagation of the particle through the interactions which is effectively giving it what the speed is. But that propagation is also the measure of inertia. We say the particle goes slow because it has inertia, it doesn't move. But it doesn't move is a statement that it doesn't move as easily as it would have moved in vacuum. That's because it's interacting. So statement that all elementary particles are getting masses is because there is a common interaction that they suffer, and there is some agent with which they interact, and that agent is the Higgs field. But we also know from quantum field theory that if there are fields, then there are corresponding quanta or particles. So similarly, Higgs field with which everybody else interacts and acquires mass because of interaction, Higgs field will also have a mass, and that mass is the Higgs boson particle that Indu mentioned. So perhaps this is closest one can get for some intuitive explanation.
I'd like to add an analogy to this, but it's just an analogy. You don't take it too far. Think of a ship or boats or an ocean. Okay, so the ocean is covering all of Earth, which is a very good approximation. Okay. And different kinds of ships. So there are metal bottom ships, there is a catamaran, there is an old rusted ship, okay, there is a square ship, there is a very streamlined ship. So different ships are floating on this ocean. And you can see that because of different surface areas, different type of material, they have different frictional force or frictional drag with respect to the sea. So some will zig past and go very fast on the sea, some will go very slowly, and some will hardly move at all. And you can think of that as a measure of the interaction with the sea, which is the Higgs field. And if you think of the waves on the sea, then it's the self-interaction of the sea with itself, and that will quantize or give you the Higgs particle. Okay, but it's an analogy. I mean, there are at least three different places where it breaks down, but it's a very good starting point to understand these interactions. Okay, now I think we should take the question from the person upstairs. Huh? Yeah. Maybe I should just take one or two last questions. Somebody had a question upstairs. Mele endu yaravadhu kekkanuma? யாரோ கேள்வி கேட்கணும்னு சொன்னாங்களே. சாப்பாடு ரெடியா? ஆமா, ரெடியா இருக்குது. யா, எஸ்.
எஸ், ஆஃப் கோர்ஸ். நவ் வாட் இஸ் த எக்ஸாம்பிள் தட் ஒன் கேன் கிவ்? பேர் ப்ரொடக்ஷன் ரியாக்ஷன்ஸ். So you can have light interacting with something and it produces positron and electrons, or particle and antiparticle, which are massive. So the photon, which is massless but carries energy, can still produce two particles which are massive, but they move at different momentum, different velocities. So it's possible, of course. Yeah, I mean, photon by itself will not produce that, because you have to conserve energy and momentum. It needs one more object to interact with, but then yes, it is possible. Sorry? On a large scale. No, not that I can think of. At least I don't know. maybe one can engineer something, but I don't have a short answer for that. Sorry.
This energy mass equivalence is so difficult to give examples of. What happens in the LHC? No. Two protons collide. Okay, but it's the energy that those protons generate and becomes a huge amount of masses, right? Every collision in the LHC gives you about 3,000 particles. So you start out with two particles, and it's not as though the two protons are getting converted into 3,000 particles. It's the energy of these protons which is getting converted, right? So this is the equivalence principle. I mean, so you have a mass-energy equivalence. So you see the interaction. It's the energy of the interaction, right?
I will just add one more thing regarding your question: can it be seen on massive scale? Please understand the relation between them is E is equal to m times c square, and c is extremely large. So if you say 1 gram of matter is to be produced, just calculate how much energy is needed. Multiply by c square and find out how much that is. Then you will see why it is not possible to produce on large scale like you and your antiparticle is produced by bombarding two lasers. It's not possible.
And one more question. A neutron is decomposing when it's free from an atom, whereas it doesn't within an atom. Why is it so?
Okay, fine. So all of you know that in the atom, apart from protons and electrons, there's also neutrons, right? These neutrons are kept there for a reason. Why are they there? Proton and electron attract each other, form a stable atom, right? But the moment I go beyond hydrogen, I go to helium. How many protons are there in helium?
Two.
Then how many neutrons are there in helium? Two. Why? Because the two protons have what charge? Both have positive charge. What will happen to positive charges? They will repel. Then how can two protons sit inside a nucleus? They should not sit, right? They should all, one proton should go to that end, the other proton should go to the other end. They should never form nuclei, right? So the reason they form nuclei is because there is strong interactions. Shyam talked about three of the four interactions I had written on the board. The strong interactions overcome this electromagnetic repulsion because it's stronger than the electromagnetic repulsion. It holds the protons together, but if you start putting more and more protons together, just the strong attraction of the protons is not enough. You must have neutrons. Neutrons have no charge. So there is no electromagnetic repulsion, right? They're not bringing in any electromagnetic repulsion. But because they also experience strong attraction, they are making the atom more and more stable. But as you see, if you start putting more and more neutrons in, the whole atom becomes unstable. And what happens? Because the atom is unstable, and you know that there's a shell model, right? All these protons and neutrons, just like the electrons, are sitting in different orbitals. So it's possible that the neutron can convert into a proton, and that is what causes that is the question, right? That beta decay happens, neutron becomes a proton, the electron and neutrino come out, right? Now, what prevents this from happening in very stable atoms? It's if you take carbon, 6, carbon 12, right? So it has 6 protons and 6 neutrons, 2 in the innermost shell and 4 in the outer one, right? Or if you take helium, 2, okay? Then these shells are very stable shells. For the neutron to convert into a proton, then it will have to go into the next higher energy orbit. There is no energy for this. And therefore, in such atoms, stably, the atom will survive and the neutron will not decay. The moment you have excess electrons, excess neutrons, which can occupy a higher energy level, and there is a space among the protons to go to the lower energy level, all those particles will beta decay. And if you look at the periodic table, you will see that if you draw a central line, the ones above it will beta minus decay, and the ones below it will beta plus decay, right? That's exactly because of this reason, because now there is an energy level into which these particles can drop, okay? That is because if you don't give that much energy, and these are all millions of electron volts of energy, it cannot be just got by thermal energy, which you can do for electron case. An electron, you can just heat it, and you know that energy may be enough for the very large electronic orbits. That is why atoms are very stable. But if you have a free neutron, there is nothing, no binding energy to overcome, and so it can easily decay. Maybe, I don't know, organizers, when should we stop? I think, yeah, no, one last question from, yeah. No, but not the participants, not the organizers. You can ask your question tomorrow to your friends, okay? Is there a computer science question or a maths question? Huh? Ask. Sorry. I mean, by the way, we are here till the evening, and many of us are around for the, there are these demo experiments in the afternoon, right? So many of us will be around. Shankar is certainly around. I am around, so you can keep asking questions if you find our stall, okay? Or if you have questions, you can write them down and give it to me, and we can send you back the answers if you give your email address or even a postal address, okay? Yeah, ask.
What is the dimension both mathematically and physically, and how do we visualize it?
Dimension, right? So often it's related to how much freedom you have to move. Okay, so you can say on the floor you can move in two directions. You can go straight or perpendicularly. Yeah, two mutually perpendicular directions you can move in. So that's two-dimensional. And if you include this room, it's you can, in addition to the two on the floor, you can move up or down. Okay, so that's another dimension. So it's related to in how many distinct ways you can move. So one way to consider distinct is to say perpendicular way. Okay, so you can obviously move in various directions on the floor, but that doesn't mean many dimensions, but two dimensions. So it's the freedom to move. Okay, so that's yeah, number of perpendicular directions to move. Yeah.
I mean, mathematically they say that we comfortably cross three dimensions and move on to multiple dimensions. So, in that, I mean, in that point of view, what is a dimension? I mean, generally, we when we speak of, in terms of mathematics, we comfortably cross three dimensions and talk about multiple dimensions.
No, but it doesn't have to be physically possible for us to imagine, right? Once you define it mathematically, you can just generalize that definition and say
three-dimension. Then the orthogonality of the definition breaks down. I mean, I do not
know. There is, yeah, so there is a notion of what orthogonal means in any arbitrary dimension as well. It may not.
Okay. So is there a way to visualize it or something?
Yeah.
It's not only, I mean, well, in terms of movement, I can talk about, but I mean, think of me as a person, right? I have many attributes. I have certain height, I have certain weight, right? I mean, I'm a professor, I'm a father, like there are many, many attributes to me, right? Think of a whole list of attributes describing me, right? And now the length of that list is not two or three or whatever, right? Whatever attributes you choose to describe for me, let's say 10 attributes, right? So I can, now then you can think of me as a point in a 10-dimensional space, right? Because now you can look at all those people with the first attribute, second attribute, third attribute and so on. So you are thinking of all these attributes as independent. This independence is what is mathematically captured by a notion of orthogonality. And then you are saying that here is a person who is an object in a 10-dimensional space, right? And then you can think of all operations that you perform on the person as performing operations on elements of the 10-dimensional space and so on. So that's a very real thing.
Thank you. Thank you. Maybe I should introduce Ramanujam from the Theoretical Computer Science Group. So that needed a computer science answer, is it? Okay, fine. So, okay, so if there are more questions, please, you are requested to write them down and give it to any one of us, now you recognize us, or to any of the volunteers who are in very dull gray t-shirts and, you know, therefore they can kind of disappear into the background, but find them and give them the questions, okay? So, Shankar wanted 2 minutes to elaborate on some answer, after which we will just close the session. I have a couple of announcements before he... maybe I'll make the announcements before people leave. So lunch is available on the other side. We have a campus. Just, you entered one gate, right? If you exit the gate and look on the other side, there's a campus on the other side. And of course, you can just follow your nose. So lunch will be served on the other side. You have 45 minutes for lunch. So there won't be formal sessions, but there will be a whole host of demo programs, which will be in various rooms around this institute. And there will be volunteers who will take you to these various rooms, so you can find out where those rooms are. So please come back around 2:15 or 2:20, okay? Or I mean, a few minutes later, but and then, you know, look around the demos. And sorry, huh? Okay, especially the two little hut like objects in front of the auditorium. So there are some experiments there. But also in various places in the institute. That was all? Anything else to say? That's it? Okay, fine. Tushank.
Yeah, so the one question actually, the thing about why the electron doesn't fall into the proton, I did not answer it properly, so I'd just like to clarify. What I said was correct, that if it's going round and round, centrifugal force will balance the electrical force and it'll be stable. But we know another fact, that an accelerating charge radiates energy. Like after all, how are radio waves produced? In your cell phone, some electrons are made to accelerate and they radiate away energy. So if the electron is going round and round the proton, it will always be radiating away energy. And then it will go, that's why it will has to always collapse. So this was a big problem in physics at the end of 19th century. Actually, it was very interesting. That time people thought that they have solved everything. Only this was a slight problem, ki why is the atom stable? Why doesn't the electron radiate away the energy? And there was the other slight problem about black body radiation. But this problem about stability of the atom is actually cannot be answered within classical mechanics. If you say that the world is just classical mechanics and electromagnetism, then you cannot have stable atoms. So quantum, this was one of the main motivations for quantum theory. Why are atoms stable?
Okay, so I hope you enjoyed yourselves. Thank you very much. So we break for lunch now. Please go to the other side and then come back for the... So there are different kinds of demos in maths, physics and computer science. So you can go and find all of them. Yeah, and there'll be volunteers who will show you where to go, okay?